Excellencies, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you and welcome to today's public forum on migration, terrorism and democracy, lessons and challenges across Asia and Africa. While the Institute of Security and International Studies has held many seminars, conference and public forum such as this. And this activity has been topical, practical, and relevant to current global events. However, I can tell you that today's forum is the most direct and immediately connected to the outside world. As we are focused today on migration, terrorism, and democracy, we can see that these issues now dominate international news headlines. These issues are global and they have far-reaching ramifications for our society and for our life. So I think we have a good subject for discussion today. It is my pleasure to speak a little bit about Ambassador Husni and Moroccan Embassy, which is our co-host today. We have cooperated and co-organized several events with the Moroccan Embassy in the past, especially in public forums and international conference about the management and challenges of the Greater Macron sub-region. Drawing on Morocco's experience and expertise in water and river management in North Africa, I take this opportunity to thank Ambassador Husni for his past work with ISIS Thailand and for his efforts in promoting Thai-Moroccan relations, which have become much more robust under Ambassador Husni's task. The two kingdoms, one in Africa and the other in mainland Southeast Asia, have much to learn from and share with each other. Indeed, Thailand and Morocco are a kind of axis in promoting South and South cooperation between two large regions. In addition, Ambassador Husni has made considerable effort to link up Morocco with ASEAN, and we welcome this effort and hope that Morocco can be the closest African partner ASEAN can count on in the future. Now, our topic today is topical, but it's not easy to address. Migration is a big news everywhere from America, Africa, to Europe and also Asia. Around here, we have had what we call irregular migration in the Indian Ocean involving Muslim Rohingya from Rakhine State in Myanmar as well as Bangladesh Muslim who have left their homes in search of better livelihoods in Malaysia, Indonesia and elsewhere, often transiting through Thailand. Allow the Mediterranean Sea, there have also been migration challenges from North Africans seeking better living in Europe. These two migration trends pose challenges to democratic rule and to the efforts to combat terrorism. Migration is made more difficult because of the rise of global terrorism, but at the same time, we still need migration to continue because of economic necessities and humanitarian concerns. You can see that Africa and Asia are listed in the title of our forum, but in fact, this week, we have seen migration and terrorism mentioned in the same context in the United States, which is supposed to be the greatest democracy on earth. So we all have a lot of things about here, there, and everywhere. I can think of no better speakers from Asia and Africa to address these issues than two former foreign ministers of these two regions. His Excellency Mr. Youssef Amrani, the former minister delegate for foreign affairs and cooperation, former Secretary General of Mediterranean Union, member of the cabinet of the Majesty King Mohammed, the sixth, the Kingdom of Morocco, and His Excellency Mr. Kasit Piromya, member of National Reform Steering Assembly, former Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Kingdom of Thailand. I believe you will find much food of thought, food for thought from today's discussion.
Well, today I think for the next hour, hour and a half, we'll try to have some intellectual engagement. I think that when we were thinking about the topic, you know, for today, I think we first have to, I would like to thank Ambassador Husni for introducing us to Mr. Amrani's trip. He was going to come here, and so I thought we would organize something like this to promote Africa-Southeast Asia relations, South-South cooperation in that context. And when we were thinking about the theme, you know, I had maybe populism and maybe some about human rights, for example. I mean, human rights is still very important around here. The Swedish Embassy having a human rights reception. Ambassador Stefan Hurstrom is here. A number of ambassadors are here. So different themes that we could have pivot this discussion around. But it was decided, I think, mutually that we would do something about migration, terrorism, and democracy. But within that context, you can see human rights still matter, and civil liberties, but also populism. We're seeing news that I think, maybe it's just me, but it seems like now we're in a kind of a very alarming, worrying stage in global life, global affairs. Maybe it's always been like this, but we just feel it more because we know more. But on the other hand, maybe this is something new. This is something new, which is we haven't been here before because of the unraveling of the international system. Before I proceed, I was so excited to get going. I'm remiss that I have to invite my partner and co-host to also provide remarks from the Moroccan side. Please, Ambassador Husni, I'm very sorry to omit, but now I've broken myself.
Good morning, everybody, excellencies, dear colleague and friends. Happy Chinese New Year, and thank you for coming today. I'm Abdeliah El Housni, the ambassador of His Majesty, the King of Morocco to the Kingdom of Thailand. And today I'm so pleased to have the privilege and the honor to introduce a very fascinating person, a very passionate person too, a man I know for more than 30 years. My former boss, my friend, our guest speaker this morning, Mr. Youssef Amrani. I have to confess that today, and we tried many times, there are many attempts to get him here to Bangkok. And let me just open this window to thank Dr. Thitinan and others who make it happen. So today we are so pleased to welcome Mr. Amrani. Mr. Amrani is an excellent communicator, very tactful diplomat, and very shrewd politician with the experience and background and career of 40 years. Mr. Amrani is now currently a member of the cabinet of His Majesty, the King of Morocco. However, prior to this assignment, he held many high positions. He was Minister Delegate for Foreign Affairs. He was Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Cooperation. He was elected Secretary General of the Union of the Mediterranean, based in Barcelona, Spain. The Union of Mediterranean is an intergovernmental organization for regional and cooperation dialogue in the Euro-Mediterranean zone, comprising of 43 countries from the European Union and others from eastern shore of the Mediterranean. Mr. Amrani was ambassador to Chile, to Panama. He was ambassador to Panama, to Mexico, to Colombia, to Nicaragua, to Belize, to El Salvador, so and others. So Mr. Amrani, he holds degree of economics from Morocco, and he graduated from the Institute of Management in Boston. Mr. Amrani is, besides his mother tongue Arabic, he's very fluent in Spanish, in English, and French. As a good debater and very vested in communicating with and through the media, Mr. Amrani appeared in many TV channels and cable network and did many interviews with CNN, BBC, Fox News, France 24, Al Jazeera, Washington Post, El País, and others. So today, Mr. Amrani will address and will share with us his experience, opinion on some major issues that on our times: democracy, migration, terrorism. So he will try to illuminate and tackle these thorny issues from new approach angle, bring us some new perspective in tackling these issues. So I think today we are all in for a good treat today. So I don't want to take that much time, and as I said, without further ado, let me return the microphone to my friend Konjay. Thank you very much.
Very well done, and I apologize. I almost skipped you, but I corrected myself in time. Look, I think that I want to proceed. As you know, there are details, personal backgrounds of our two former foreign ministers. We can talk a lot about a lot of issues today. In the news, you see that migration is very much at the forefront. We're talking today from perspectives in Africa, Asia, but you can also see in North America, they have some issues about migration, about the fear of terrorism, and about the fabric of democracy that is being challenged. And we will have, by the way, this Friday, a public forum on President Donald Trump and implications, ramifications for Southeast Asia and Thailand. So let me proceed to the speakers. I think I've never worked for Minister Kasit, His Excellency Kasit Piromya, but he also has a long dossier. Yeah, but I would just highlight that he also was former ambassador. And he was posted to Moscow, Jakarta, Bonn, Berlin, Tokyo, Washington. So what I want to say is that, you know, he is not just a member of the National Steering Committee, Thailand, former foreign minister, also senior leader with the Democrat Party and so on, but in our system, he has had a distinguished, illustrious career path, combining many things. Graduated from here, also has lectured at universities, advised students, and so on and so on. Let me proceed with Mr. Amrani first. I think from your experience, you know, we have migration challenges around here, especially from the Andaman Sea, the Rohingya, the Rakhine State, but also we have migrants here working from Myanmar. You know, when I think of a wall that the U.S. wants to build to prevent Mexicans, I think, you know, the wages in the U.S. would skyrocket. You know, all is same with us. We have Myanmar workers here that are really about 12% of the Thai workforce. So we handle them, and then they work here, and you know, there's some issues, but overall it's fine. But terrorism here is something new. Not for us as much, but I think the recent spate of attacks in the Rakhine State in Myanmar involve some terrorist backing in October, since October last year. So these are issues that we're also concerned about, but we're a little bit behind you. So we'll look to you and we'll see some, we'll try to tease out some lessons and challenges from your experience and expertise.
Let me, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me here to exchange with you some views and some experiences as someone who is coming from Morocco, from north of Africa, from the Arab world, next to Europe, which is our main partner, and to give you some modest experience how we are living in this very complex world. Lessons learned, I think the title is very important. Yesterday I was in with Mr. Ambassador Husni's car, and I found the book in his car. And he didn't read this book, and he was doing something. And when he came back, he found almost me. I was impressed by your vision here in Thailand, Mr. Minister, how you are tackling these issues. And I found in this book, you know, that I read very, that your approach, your vision is similar to ours. And I saw that we are all targeted by these challenges, migration, by terrorism, how to build up coherent and democratic states. We are in Europe, in North Africa, in the Mediterranean, in Africa we are facing, and the Arab world, we are facing the same challenges. And also we have the same vision, and maybe the approaches are different, but today we need to work together. We need to face these challenges together, because nobody is safe today. Al-Qaeda, Boko Haram, ISIS have a global vision. They are trying to, they don't have frontiers in their action. They can be active in London, in Paris, in Rabat, Casablanca, and even here in your region. So we have to be very careful. You see, this issue of ISIS, 5 years ago, Morocco was in the Security Council. And I presented the first resolution on Syria in the Security Council. This resolution was vetoed at that time by Russia and China. And at that time, 5-6 years ago, there was no ISIS. There was only Jabhat Nusra linked to Al-Qaeda in Iraq, trying to put some. But because Security Council was divided, because we didn't act accordingly to face the challenge, that we find ourselves today before a monster. We could have solved the problem. So that's why maybe in my intervention, I will speak also about the reform of the Security Council. I think it is, and I am very happy today, and thank you for being here. Very praise of a lot of ambassadors who have experience, who have been working all over the world to show that today we need action-oriented strategies to fight these challenges. Let me say first, as introduction, I'm very happy here to be here in Thailand. Thanks to you, to all of you, to Ambassador Husni, because we have a strong relations with Thailand. We have been working for a long time together within this political dialogue I can see also the presence of our former Thai ambassador in Rabat, that whom I salute. And I think we, thanks to the actions of both ambassadors and the commitment of countries, we have been able to move forward in building up and designing new relations based on shared prosperity and common objectives and through innovative tools. This, I think, something people think that maybe Brazil or is far from Morocco, or that Thailand is far from Morocco. But you know, we were able to develop with Brazil, with Thailand, some innovative tools, political dialogue, economic cooperation, free trade agreements. And today we are moving, because Morocco believes that South-South cooperation is essential, and that's why we want to build up new relations with the whole country of Southeast Asia, and all the agreements that we have signed lately with the Southeast Asian country shows that Morocco is not only willing to develop a legal framework supported by the parties, but also to examine and new opportunities for trade. Because at the end of the day, and I think the experience of the Asian country is essential, how much money do you make, and how much job do you create, and how much growth do you promote? What is, and this is something, it's a prerequisite for a zone of peace, stability. So today, stability and security are essential. Listen, I have, I think, 20 minutes or 30 minutes. I would like to give you some hints, and then we can maybe discuss. I think today we need to talk about the Middle East, because the Middle East and North Africa is essential for the stability of the world today. And before talking about tomorrow, we must confront today's bleak reality and come in turn with some difficult truths in the region. First, there is this reality of violent conflicts that are targeting the region. Situation in Syria, Libya, Yemen, Iraq, all this today is impacting not only our region, but also our neighbors. I can see Portugal, massive Portugal of Germany. You see the big political mess today in Europe with this migration issue is linked to the situation in Syria. We were not able to solve the ongoing conflict in the region, and that's why we don't have the necessary tools to face these challenges as migration is concerned, for example. We should not also forget the key Palestinian issue. It is today, of course, relegated in the priorities of the international agenda. It's not anymore at the core of the hierarchy of priorities, but it remains at the heart of the grievance across the Arab Muslim world. And also this issue should be addressed. I'm not going to do it. And then, as countries of the Middle East, we should not only blame the others of our situation. We should also do our own homework internally. And I'm saying that with a great sense of responsibility. We need to do our own homework as countries of the South, as far as democracy, as problems of governance, as problems of transparency, and the lack of development has become today one of the priorities. When I'm talking about development, I'm talking about the creation of jobs, the meeting the expectations of the young generation in our region. And maybe in some countries of our region, we have failed to address this issue because of, well, there are many elements, education, democracy, and so on. But I think, and the strong institutions, and we need, and our friend was talking about democracy. Democracy today is essential. We cannot move in our region, in the Middle East, in North Africa, in Africa, if we don't have a strong state. Because failed states, they are only an appeal, a vacuum for the extremists and for Al-Qaeda, Boko Haram, and so on. And maybe when we talk about terrorism, I will talk about terrorism. I will maybe exchange with you what is our approach and what we should do, because we are, as I was saying earlier, we are all targeted. So this brings me to the issue of Daesh and other radicalized groups that have taken hostage they have hijacked Islam to promote the culture of hate and the exclusion of the others. And this is something I think that should be dealt with today commonly with all our partners. So, because these people are not only promoting the culture of hate and exclusion, but also they explore the fear of disenfranchised individuals, okay, in order to spread division and so on. So what the question I want to ask and ask you and ask for ourselves, what does all this mean for our region, for the future of the Middle East and its place in the world? Of course, these questions are indeed enormous, but the answers have other common denominator, is that we need to work together. This leads me again to, and I already tackled this at the beginning, this issue of the Security Council, international community, where today we are unable to solve this conflict. We have tried with the Americans, we have tried with Security Council, now we are trying with the Russians, with Turkey, with Iran, but we are moving nowhere. There is a problem, so we need, you know, I know that we need to see how we can tackle this issue. So this brings me to one first conclusion, that presently no one, whether strong is, can find a solution alone to this issue. No country alone can find an exit solution for this crisis. So that's why we need to come with an alternative to the reform of the Security Council. It is imperative, and I see the ambassador of Brazil, and Brazil was one of the key countries promoting this Café para Todos to the reform of the Security Council. And we need to have a UN organization more representative of the current regional and global balances. I think nowhere it changes. So in order to deal efficiently with this crisis. So today, we need, as I was saying earlier, to move forward and play our part in the Azov region. And I said that at the beginning, I would try maybe to see what are the elements that we should do. I think that we need to first establish a model of global governance based on the respect of the specificities of each country. It's important, and I think your experience here in the region is essential. In doing so, of course, we have to respect some parameters. The parameters is the respect of the integrity and territorial of the countries. It's essential, because we need to work as a regional grouping, and maybe later on, I would like to hear from you, your experience of the Asian country. I lived a long time in Latin America, and I saw that the experience of Mercosur, the experience of Comunidad Andina, or the UNASUR today, are very good tools, you know, to work together to not only to overcome the political problems, but also to create this zone of shared prosperity, free trade agreement, and so on. And your experience here in the region is enormous. It's important. And that's also, we need, and I'm talking here as a Mediterranean, as a Maghrebian, we need, as an Arab also, we need to work in building up strong and coherent regional groupings. Unfortunately, in Arab world today, it's not working, except the experience of the Gulf Cooperation Council, which has had set up something which is coherent, which is working, which is creating some, not only a platform for dialogue, but also to create wealth, to create trade, and so on. This, I think, today is lacking at the level of the Maghreb. Unfortunately, the Maghreb, the five countries, is not working. We have this morning I was talking to the Chargé d'Affaires of Libya here today. If the Maghreb was working, maybe we should have solved the Libyan issue. through political dialogue, through the respect of the unity and territorial integrity of Libya, a political solution and a compromise in order to move forward. And today, again here, we have in the doors of Europe a situation which is complicated and should be addressed correctly. Of course, taking into consideration the aspirations of the Libyan people. Two, my second element in this moving forward is we need to work on the building of a foundation of a new, fair economic order. Three, I was talking about it, is to work for strong and proactive regional integration, and we need the fourth element, which is essential today, and I will maybe take some 2 minutes. It is we need to address our region's issue of identity. We must work together. Today is a priority to deconstruct the jihadist narrative. Because it is important today in fighting terrorism to intervene militarily. Yes, it's important. It is good to promote security and exchange of intelligence. Yes, it is important. But it's not sufficient. If we don't work on the minds, what we call in Morocco the cultural and the cultural values of this strategy to deconstruct the jihadist narrative. And we need to do it for ourselves, but also for our partners. And we need to do work together. What we are doing in Morocco as far as training of imams, as far as, and we're doing it with some other countries in Spain, with France, how to work together, because today, not only the Maghreb countries are targeted, you know, the Spain is targeted, France is targeted, UK is targeted. The English have understood and they have a strategy now in the FCO to work with Azhar and other religious leaders in the region to deconstruct the jihadist narrative. Even in, Mr. Minister, even in your country, in your region, this issue should be dealt with. Some countries in the region are trying to work. I know that in Malaysia and Indonesia, they are trying with some institutions like Musawa and so on, trying to deconstruct the jihadist narrative and try to promote the real values of Islam. Because as I was saying earlier, Islam today is hijacked by a minority. And today, the foremost challenge is to how to manage this radicalized people. We must have in mind also that we need to deal with these foreign fighters, and they will, once these issues have been solved, they will be come back, and they will harm us, and we need to have the strategy of communications. Communications is essential endeavors, because they are, I will say it entre parenthèses, they are good. They are good, the extremists, in an expert in promoting the culture of hate. They control internet. They know how to work with radical, how to sell these bad ideas. I call them the bad guys. So we need maybe to use the same tools, internet, social media, to counter, to end. But we need also to present an alternative narrative, which is consistent. And this is something I think which is important. So this is the way how to fight. And states, individually, we have to work together again. This is something important. We have to work together, we have to exchange communication, information, and we need to work on social media and with the young people. Because today, this extremist movement are targeting young people, men and women everywhere. And also the role of women is essential in deconstructing the jihadist narrative. We need to have some readings of the religious element in order to. Of course, this requires. I'm sorry to be very long on this issue, but this requires an approach based on a realistic and a comprehensive and comprehensive and consistent strategy that involves all the people concerned by this strategy, the religious leaders. So that's why, you know, when I make some parentheses for you, I don't agree with this language of expelling Muslims and so on. This doesn't help. This only helps encourages Islamophobia. We have to be very careful. We have to work in dialogue and promoting real values of peace and tolerance and educating people. Education is essentially important. In Morocco, we have understood that this needs a comprehensive approach. Education is essential, especially in Muslim countries. We need to review the education books, like some countries did in the Arab world. Because when we were trying to review our school books, we found some reference to jihad. So we need to see, because some conservatives, they try to introduce some this kind of element on education. And that's why it is important to use them also, the religious leaders, to promote this culture of tolerance and the real Islam, because and Sunni Islam. And you need to have the leaders at the level of the religion, but also politically. And thanks God, I say, Morocco had a leader, King Mohammed II was leading all these reforms, all these changes, and this will come again to your point that you have before raised is the question of democracy and leadership. Because Morocco, I will talk about 2-3 minutes on this issue, how we were able today to elaborate a singular Moroccan model based on global vision and citizen-based grassroots approach based on modernity. Three elements were essential in our approach. We had a leader. Leadership was essential. We didn't wait for the Arab Spring to make the reforms in our country to promote democracy. We have no complex, no taboos as far as democracy is human right, because we have a leader who said that we need to go. Then we had the vision. And our vision was very simple. Vision was based on building up a democratic state. This was our vision. And approach is participatory democracies. Tools are all over the world. Because at the end of the day, we share the same values as transparency, democracy, and we had to work on it. We saw change as an opportunity to work, not to resist. Other countries in the region resisted change. We said, this, what's happening in the world, we should reinforce our democracy, we should work further. And this is, I think, we worked for democratic and plural open society. So I don't have time to elaborate more on the Moroccan, if I say the Moroccan model, but we wanted to walk on our two legs. Or if I may say differently, our model, our approach was two parts, faces of the same coin. The political development, democracy, human rights, transparency, and the economic, the other leg. Because if we don't walk in the two legs, you fall down. So we had to work, promote on democracy, elections, constitutions, did everything with no complex. And we accept the result of the elections, even if some parties don't agree with others. But this is democracy. You have to listen to the other, you have to compromise, and you have to work forward. And the key in our experience is the compromise. We have to compromise on all issues. We have a very modern constitution. And our constitution today defines Morocco as a multifaceted country, as a African, Arab, Muslim. We don't forget our Jewish dimension in our Berber dimension. It is today in our constitution. Gender equality, and I'm the ambassador of Sweden must be happy. Gender equality today is in our constitution, not thanks to you, thanks to Moroccan women liberation movements. They were fighting, but I'm just joking. But because the women in Morocco, we have a strong, and they were able to fight and to obtain this equality. And our reform process was to respond to the expectation of the Moroccan people themselves. So we had the elections. Now we are blocked. We have no government. Because again, this is democracy. Because we are trying to compromise. We had very transparent elections, and we are now waiting to form a government. But what all this reform process led us today to be respected at the level internationally, you know, and the flow of that investment is flowing to Morocco, it's going to working, the economy is safe, and we are in the process now of diversification of our partners, and that's why we are here present with the excellent ambassador of Morocco in Asia to promote these relations. We are very present in Africa. Africa today is one of our top priorities in foreign policy. And yesterday, Morocco has joined again the African Union after a long absence. Because for us, what is important is that we need our political model to participate in the peaceful and stable future of our region. Now, I need to talk about terrorism a little bit and talk about migration. Migration is a very key issue for us. Morocco was a country who was exporting migration 20 years ago. We were have a lot of Moroccan migrants going abroad. It's not the case anymore. Not only because we have controlled our frontiers, but we have created capacities and possibilities for our young to stay in our country. Now we had to face a new difficulty, is the sub-Saharan migrants who are coming to Morocco. So we have to deal with this. And again, Morocco has shown the way with a new policy for the migrants. So we have decided on new tools to respect human dignity, to give to these sub-Saharan migrants in Morocco the same rights as the Moroccans, as far as education, as far, and we're obliged to set up a new migratory asylum policy. Because these are our brothers, and we have to work. So we have to be, to show our solidarity. So we have this new migration situation. I think as a migration issue, three elements are or fundamentals are essential: the promotion of security, the imperative of share growth, and the duty of solidarity. And with this, we have worked together with our partners in Europe. Thanks to, I don't know if the Spain ambassador is here, no. But thanks to the relation between Morocco and Spain, for example, we were able to transform humanitarian crisis into a new model of cooperation and governance in the region. You see, as far as migration, security measures are important. Border controls, Frontex with the European Union, security, military cooperation, maritime cooperation is important. We need to fight against illegal migration and the mafias. Because today, people who deal in migration become, it's a business today. Mafias are trying to export human beings to export the heroin. So it is important to develop this security. But the second element was essential is to promote growth. We need to address the root causes of migration. We need to do our own homework in the region, in Africa and elsewhere to create the necessary conditions for young to find jobs through the tools innovation, enterprise creation, encouragement of initiatives. And this I think we should do, and we need our partners to be with us, you know, from the European Union and so on. And this is something is essential. And we need to promote the duty of solidarity. to train people. And it's not easy. It's not easy because it's today it's a major issue which concerns, you know, all countries. Look, listen, I remember, I'm not going to say any secret, Mr. Ambassador of Germany, but today for Mrs. Merkel, the issue of migration is essential for their internal policy. If we don't tackle these issues of migration in Europe today, there is this risk of growing importance of the Eurosceptics movements and racist movement, and we need to work with our European partners to find solutions to these migratory issues. We need to end the conflicts, and this, because this is more than, it's not a migratory issue, it's more refugee issue, but it is also, it's, in Europe today, there is a misunderstanding between or the, between the migrants for economic reasons and the refugee. How much time do you have more? So when I need to maybe to go on terrorism?
A few minutes.
3 minutes, okay. So maybe I would like to, again, to tackle this issue of terrorism, which is linked to this issue of migration, so on. And the direct threat it poses to all of us, in Europe, in Africa, in the Middle East, even in Asia. Violent extremism, the radicalization is a really big threat for us. We are working on security and intelligence. We are dismantling cells, but this is not enough. Because, of course, I said it earlier, we were not able to, as international community, to solve the conflicts. And these conflicts are trying to, you know, in Iraq, in Syria, Libya, the extremists are trying to sell these ideas, and they lack to this vacuum of disorder to promote this culture of hate. So we have to fight them in this ground. It is important and urgent to launch an efficient counter discourse online and through the media within a responsible media environment. It is also imperative to promote diversity within Islam and advocate models, offer women new perspective and patient responses. Because also women today are targeted, and we see that women are going to Syria and to Iraq and to Libya and to fight, but also they are educated, they're young, so the women are important, and this is, I think, some importance has to be given to this comprehensive and coherent process I earlier mentioned, you know. Because beyond achieving security dimension, fair human development, through combating poverty, I think it's important, but sometimes it's not enough. Because when we see the jihadists in Europe, these people are not poor, they have some of them have education, so there is something else. So what we need, in fact, the response we need to fight this kind of terrorism, I will summarize now, and maybe we can have a debate on this issue. We need to work at the political level in our region and elsewhere through reform processes, gender parity, reforms of the constitution. In Morocco, we have this reform of the Mudawana, which is the law that introduces gender equality. Second dimension is the security level through collaboration, cooperation, and we have this cooperation with the service intelligence. It's important. Thanks to the cooperation with our service intelligence, with European service, we were able to dismantle a lot of cells in Europe and elsewhere. And this, I think, something it's essential. And today, everybody, you know, the secret services, they are a little bit, you know, they don't want to exchange. But today, I think, everybody's exchanging. There is a commitment from all to fight this terrorism, you know. We need to also work on women, I say that. And it is clear that Daesh is also changing its radicalization methods permanently. So we need to adapt and we need to follow up. At the social level, of course, the creating jobs for the young generation. At the, and the last dimension is the what I said and I developed during this conference is the cultural and religious level deconstruction of the jihadist narrative. So today, if I may conclude, that the terrorist threat and rise of radical rhetoric calling for violence have never been so significant. It is strong, it is important. The number of people involved, the diversity of their origin and profiles, their operating methods, and increasing number of targets are the origin of many threats targeting us all in the Middle East, in Asia, in Africa, and even in Latin America. Even America. So we are, I think I tried to outline it that the de-radicalization mechanisms are not enough. However, they should be integrated today into any national strategy. Cooperation is needed. Coherence between all strategies is essential. And Daesh and other extremist movements should be combated. So beyond the security dimension, we need the involvement of the media, because the media is essential in our region, and especially in the Arab world, because we have to be very careful, because some media are trying to promote this culture of hate of the other, of the Christian, and this is something that has nothing to do with Islam, has nothing to do with the values of Islam, and some work has to be done at the level of the countries of the region. And when I'm saying countries of region, I think it's countries of the Middle East and North Africa. So we need to learn also from you. And this is my last word, because I want my last, learn from you, because you were able in your region through this regional integration, through this dialogue, through this building of institutions to create this culture of compassion, understanding each other. Of course, we are Arabs and Mediterranean, we're not like quite like you, but I think we should also use your kind of tools, you know, cooperation, political dialogue, in order to reach a zone of peace and stability and shared prosperity. Thank you very much.